Tesla has now ramped up back to 3,000 cars per week at the Giga Shanghai, and the works at Giga Berlin are still continuing despite the crisis. But things aren't looking as good for legacy car makers. A document has leaked which shows how many electric cars Ford and GM plan to produce until 2026, and the number is really pathetic. However, talking of GM, there's an absolute surprising development. Brace yourselves. An internal source at GM told us that they are planning to bring back the EV1 in an updated form. Whoa.
And the current health crisis is having a fascinating effect. The air quality in major cities is drastically improving. Then we have a new report from the American Physical Society, which is quite optimistic on the US progress on fusion energy. And lastly, a transport mode, which we didn't yet talk about, but which certainly doesn't get enough love. Monorails. They were supposed to be the future, but why aren't they everywhere? A lot to talk about, so stay tuned. So while all gigafactories, except Giga Shanghai, are now trying to build ventilators, Giga Shanghai is now the only factory which continues to build cars. Nay, even ramped up production back to the target 3,000 cars per week. Giga Shanghai is on track to build 150,000 cars as planned for this year. That's why we still believe that Tesla will be the only car manufacturer on this planet who will sell more cars in 2020 than in 2019, despite the crisis. And construction works on Giga Berlin are still continuing as if nothing happened. Now Tesla even contracted the German electricity utility company E.ON to build a large solar or wind farm to power the Giga Berlin in a renewable fashion. So while Tesla being the only company which continues growing in this crisis, we are pretty sure that the legacy car makers will run into severe trouble, and many of them will have to be bailed out at some point. This will be especially true for Ford and GM. A document was presented to Reuters, according to which both companies only want to produce 320,000 electric cars by 2026. Yes, you heard that right. 320,000 electric cars in 6 years' time. That's less than Tesla thought alone in 2019. But of course, Ford and GM want to build 5 million petrol SUVs by 2026. The upper management of these companies must be completely stupid. We would like to be more diplomatic, but this is so stupid that we really don't know what to say. Tesla will be selling millions of electric cars per year by 2026. Even by 2023, the price per kilowatt hour for batteries will have dropped by so much that it will actually be cheaper to build an electric car rather than a petrol car. The car industry around the whole globe is shifting towards electric cars, and the EV market is growing exponentially. We have new electric car startups every year pushing into this new market, backed by giant VC funds. And amidst this, GM and Ford still believe that they will survive in 2026 by producing 5 million gasoline SUVs. This is absolute madness. The global electric car market by 2026 will be so large that if they don't fully commit to EVs very soon, they won't exist anymore in 2026. That's how simple it is. This is another example that the upper management of these companies don't understand the growth of disruptive technologies. I don't know. Don't they even have one single person being capable to do some kind of curve fitting? And to look at some electric car growth curves, they would find that the trend is exponential. But okay, we can rant all we want. If they prefer to dig their own grave, so be it.
We would be way more angry about this. However, we received news from an internal source at GM that they are actually planning to bring back the EV1 in a limited production run. It will be, of course, updated with current day lithium ion batteries, giving it a range of about 300 miles. And apparently the design will even be updated too, and will more closely resemble the GM Ultralight concept which we were shown in Demolition Man. And of course this was an April Fool's joke. We're really sorry about this, we hope you forgive us, but the idea of bringing back the EV1 would be so cool. It would be so amazing if GM would bring back the EV1 in an updated form, but we guess instead they want to produce millions of SUVs. An updated, cool-looking EV1 would certainly find many buyers, but apparently GM doesn't understand it. So yeah, GM, bye, was nice knowing you. Have fun trying to produce millions of SUVs by 2026. Huh? Huh? That plan will certainly work. Very good plan. We are sure that when GM finally goes bankrupt, and let's be realistic, at some point they cannot be bailed out anymore, someone might try to revive the EV1. But then hopefully with a 500 mile range, under 5 seconds, 200 kilometers per hour or 60 miles per hour, an updated futuristic design, and an updated interior with lots of screens. That would be wow. One can still dream, right? One can still dream.
Meanwhile, the global crisis is already giving us a glimpse of what would happen if humans would disappear. There was this documentary called Life After People, where it was analyzed what would happen with all our technological achievements if humanity suddenly disappeared. Fortunately, this won't happen now, but even in this crisis, where many people around the globe are currently staying at home, we can see some strong effects on the environment. The satellite image here shows the concentration of nitrous oxide, a pollutant gas emitted by fossil fuel sources, and which is, by the way, really unhealthy. In March, before and after the lockdown in France, the difference is quite drastic. The smoke levels in Los Angeles also went down by so much that you can even see a clear skyline. This is how downtown LA usually looks like from far away. And this is how it looks right now. You can clearly see the skyline, but more so, you can see much further, even the clear outline of the hills very far away, which under regular circumstances wouldn't be visible. So dear gasoline and diesel lovers, now you see firsthand how our future will look like when finally everyone is driving an electric car, and when finally all electricity comes from renewable energy sources. This is a foreshadowing of things to come. Talking of clean forms of energy, now we of course know that the future will be powered by renewable energy sources. If not for the love of clean air, then simply because of economic reasons, the price of renewables is just falling and falling. And it's just much cheaper to build new renewable energy farms than fossil fuel power plants. Apart from solar and wind, many are still pursuing fusion energy. We already talked about fusion energy in this video here, about the so-called tokamak fusion reactor design, such as will be used in the European fusion energy project ITER. And we also talked about a novel form of fusion energy generation using the hydrogen-boron-11 reaction in this video here. And in a new report by the Princeton Plasma Physics Laboratory, link in the description, a plan is laid out on how the US could further progress in fusion energy. Of course, it makes sense that the US also pursues fusion energy on its own, because even though the US is part of the ITER collaboration, the ITER reactor is currently being built in France as we speak. So having an own fusion reactor in the US certainly makes sense. The report suggests the following steps. First, research should be driven by the mission to enable construction of a fusion pilot plant that produces net electricity and thereby establishes the scientific and technological basis for commercial fusion energy. Second, development of this mission should include immediate design of a new US tokamak, or donut-shaped fusion facility. Third, advancing theory and modeling capabilities needed to understand and sustain burning plasmas, in which the plasma is chiefly heated by fusion reactions. The US should also sustain full membership in ITER. 4. Scaling up research in plasma science fields, ranging from astrophysics to nanotechnology.
Sounds good, and we sincerely hope that the US will try to construct their own tokamak fusion reactor so that we have more than one fusion test reactor worldwide, and the scientists can then exchange data, therefore accelerating the development of fusion energy. But realistically, until fusion power will become commercially available, we will have to wait at least 10, possibly maybe even 15 to 20 years. And now, imagine the future. Moon and Mars spaces thanks to Elon, Starship flying to the moon to Mars, air taxis, hyperloops, boring tunnels, controlling devices with neural interfaces, even experiencing super realistic VR with Neuralink via direct feed into the optical center of the brain, autonomous delivery drones and delivery bots, life extension through genetic engineering, futuristic looking electric cars such as Cybertruck with 1000 kilometer ranges or more, renewable energy and even fusion energy. Now, we believe that the people who want to make us believe that the future will be so bad and grim and dark are idiots. Maybe they had some bad experiences in life, such as probably the writers of Star Trek Picard or Star Trek Discovery, certainly. But that doesn't mean that we should actually believe that the future will be bad. Quite the contrary. We in fact believe that the future will be awesome. We should stay optimistic despite some crises and setbacks. We survived the fall of the Roman Empire and the subsequent Dark Ages. We survived the Justinian Plague and the Black Death. We survived two insane world wars. We even were close to a nuclear war. We survived the Spanish flu. Hell, we even survived gigantic volcano eruptions 70,000 years ago that nearly wiped us out. Only a few thousand humans remained on the planet back then. But we got back on our feet. We came back. Bam! Stronger than ever before. That's what we do, you know? We experience some bad times and bam, we come back stronger than before. Okay, that was now a small motivational speech to lift the spirits in these dark times.
And one thing that the future always promised us and about which we didn't yet talk about are monorails. You know that we love every mode of transportation. And we talk about all modes of transportation in our disruption reports. But we haven't talked about monorails yet. Whenever we are in a city which has a monorail, we just have to ride the monorail as if some invisible power forces us to do so. We took a ride on the monorail in Shenzhen or on the Miami Metro Mover, and of course on the Las Vegas monorail. But we always wondered, why aren't these monorails everywhere? They were always promised to us as the transportation mode of the future. All the old visions of the future showed us cities filled with monorails, even as far back as the 19th century, where they envisioned some seriously cool steampunk monorails. So why didn't they happen on a large scale? Now, while a recent report actually suggests that the monorail market will grow by an annual rate of 23.8% in the next years. Link in the description, the development of monorails turns out actually doesn't make sense in all cities. In a study conducted by the city of Austin, which was toying around with the idea of constructing a monorail quite a while ago, the pros and cons were listed quite nicely. While light rail wins in convenience, being a proven technology, allowing for more stops, and new stops could be easily added after construction. The monorail wins at safety, has only minimal disruption during construction, takes minimal amount of road space, and can be operated without a driver. And monorail and light rail are kind of similar with regard to construction and operating costs and speed. Aesthetics is of course subjective. We personally prefer the monorail aesthetics. but probably because we are severely influenced by the 80s retrofuturism and by watching too many sci-fi movies. Others might hate the monorail aesthetics, but if light rail and monorail are quite comparable, then why aren't there as many monorail lines as light rail lines in the world? Subway and monorail are even quite comparable regarding the maximum capacity of commuted passengers per hour per direction, with a value of 30 to 40,000 passengers per hour per direction.
Subways, by the way, are much more expensive to construct than monorails. Turns out that monorails only have an advantage over light rail in extremely densely populated and densely constructed urban areas. So in such areas, construction of monorails certainly makes a lot of sense. It should therefore come as no surprise that the longest monorail lines are all located in Asia, and that the biggest future monorail projects are all planned for Asia, with the notable exceptions of Rio de Janeiro and Cairo. In Japan, monorails are pretty standard in quite a few cities, such as Chiba or, of course, Tokyo. We also have quite long monorail lines in South Korea, such as the Daegu monorail. Then we have the Mumbai monorail in India, and the longest one is in a city which probably most people haven't even heard of yet, namely Chongqing in China. With a length of 98 kilometers, this city boasts the longest monorail line in the world, and it can transport 32,000 passengers per hour per direction. So around as many as a subway can transport. Now Chongqing, by the way, is in our opinion the most cyberpunk city on this planet. Seriously, this city is so over the top cyberpunk that even Shanghai is really struggling to compete regarding cyberpunkness. And of course, the monorail certainly adds even more to the futuristic feel of this city. They, by the way, also have some quite excellent spicy noodles there. Now regarding the Chongqing monorail, it is still being constantly expanded and thus growing and growing. So it is not surprising that the very dense Asian megacities are the best place for monorails, and that is also where we will see the strongest future monorail development, with many more new projects in the pipeline for Asia. The future that we saw drawn in those books and read as kids in the 50s, 60s, 70s or 80s is indeed happening in parts of the world, but unfortunately not so much in the West. It is happening in Asia because of the insane population density and the very dense urban areas there, mainly in China, South Korea, Japan, and India. But we sincerely hope that fueled by the growth of monorails in Asia, the monorail will maybe catch on also a bit more in the West.
So what do you say to GM and Ford's failure regarding electric cars? Do you agree with us that they are basically digging their own grave?
And the EV1? I mean, even though it was only an April Fool's joke, it would be super awesome to see the EV1 return, right?
And what's your opinion on monorails? Do you think that we should have more of them?
So you just watched the JS Disruption Report on every Wednesday, where we give you our honest opinions on the most recent developments in disruptive technologies such as electric cars and even monorails, and many more.
So thanks for turning on the show, and I would say, on to the future!